This is the mold design lecture. All right, so remember that there are lots of different types of molding, talking specifically about molding plastics. So we've talked about these in processes two, compression molding, transfer molding, injection molding, all of these. These are molding processes that you need to know, you know, at least be familiar with what they are. But in this lecture, we're going to deal with injection molding almost exclusively. All right, so here's an example of a pretty impressive injection mold. You can see the numbers there. This is it's making millions of parts in a shift. So looks like bottle cap molds there. So lots and lots of cavities, 4 second cycle time. You know, 100, almost 100 parts every 4 seconds. That's making a lot of plastic. So that's just an example of a mold. So some of the key things to keep in mind when you're designing a mold, going to be, you know, the end use, of the product, the size of the part. So if it's a really tiny part or a large part, that's going to influence some of what you, you know, the number of cavities per mold and things like that. The number of parts to be produced. So are you making tens of thousands of parts? Are you making millions of parts? Are you making millions of parts in a shift? So the total number of parts that you're going to produce has a huge influence over your design decisions. You know, that's one of the really big ones. Of course, the tooling cost, and that's, we looked at the break-even cost earlier in the semester about design decisions. That would definitely play in right there. You remember that trade-off break-even point diagram where we had two separate processes, two with different tooling cost, and the change in the where it made sense to go with a more expensive mold or mold with higher capacity. So review that if you don't remember that. Sometimes family molds are a good idea. Sometimes family molds are a bad idea. So what a family mold is it's, if you ever put together one of those models, like a model airplane or model tank or whatever, and you would get the parts would all be stuck together on a sprue or runner system. You know, everyone calls it a sprue, but it's actually the runner system that's attaching all those bits and pieces. They're all parts of the same family, so they're all in the same mold. So every time the mold closes, you get a whole set of tank tread parts, you know, the entire assembly. Or maybe you're making a computer mouse or something like that. The mold, a family mold, might have all of the components for that mouse molded simultaneously, you know, the bottom and the top and the buttons and things like that. So in that case, it might make sense to have a family mold where you mold, for a specific component. I was talking to a guy that was working at a place that had made the mistake of having family molds for two separate products in the same mold. So you had bracket A and all of its components molded at the same time that you molded bracket B. So that's a terrible idea. So what they found out really quickly is that it's impossible to ever get that balance. You're always going to wind up with a surplus of bracket A or component A, or an excess of component B. So I don't understand a world where that would ever be a good idea. Let's see. This is just an aside. If you haven't seen the NX Mold Wizard, you already have some skill with NX. I would recommend that you go out. Some of you guys are using this for your senior project. I think that's a great tool to learn, not only for learning it as an NX tool, but also for understanding mold design a little bit better and what goes into injection molding. So I will say that it's real easy to oversimplify the idea of injection molding. So let me just go back to the introductory slide there. So this is kind of the idea of a mold that might make Legos. And this is one that I've toyed with making for some time. I need to actually get down there and cut it in metal. I've finally got the whole thing designed. But But it's real easy to kind of think, oh yeah, I understand. There's two metal parts, they come together, and the plastic bit comes out. But as you'll find out as we go through this, there's more involved in it than just two sides of a mold that open up. You know, that's what you always see in the diagrams and things. We're going to go into a little bit more depth today. Also, it's kind of a good idea to go out and, you know, just like die set design, a lot of the components used in an injection mold are standard off-the-shelf parts. And one thing that you can, that'll make you a better designer, even of products that are going to be injection molded, not necessarily injection molds themselves, but go out and look at some catalogs, some people that sell things related to injection molds. So there's an example on the page there. All right, so some more design considerations. The tolerances, you know, the tolerance of your part is going to dictate, you know, sort of the a lot that goes into your die. How much are you going to have to compensate for shrinkage? How precisely will you need to do that? Are the parts going to need to fit together with other parts? Things like that. Let's see here. Mold shrinkage. You should already be aware from processes too that when plastics are molded, they will tend to shrink, and so the molds are made oversized so that when the part shrinks down, it's at its final dimensions. So in general, the way that you compensate for that in the design is you take the model of the finished part, and you scale it up, and you know, with your CAD system, and then you design your mold around that scaled up part. Let's see. There's the draft angle, the taper on the wall, so that the part can be withdrawn. That allows the mold, when the mold opens up, as soon as the mold begins to open up, if you have draft angles, and you guys know what I'm talking about when I'm talking about draft angles. You know, so here's a part without a draft angle. Where'd my mouse go? All right, so if we were to take and withdraw this part out of the mold like this, so as we pull down, you see there's no draft angle. There's still contact all the way around this part with the sides of the mold. So this rectangle here is the part, and this is sort of the mold cavity here. So that pulls a vacuum on the inside here, and you also have friction against the walls there. Whereas if you have a part like this that's got a taper on it, it's got a draft on it, then it's just as soon as the part starts to come out of the mold, you have space in between the wall of the mold and the component itself. So that allows air to come in and relieves all of the friction and just allows it to turn loose immediately. So these are the draft angles, but then you already knew that, I know that. Let's see, the wall thicknesses for plastics, for designing wall thicknesses, number one, they should be kept fairly thin. You should refer to, there should be, you know, by the time you decide on what type of plastic you're going to be molding, you should be able to go out and find the manufacturer or some supplier of that plastic resin. They'll make recommendations on wall thicknesses and things like that. A lot of times these companies will have design guides, and I'll include a link to a design guide here later on. It's in the lecture notes there, and I'll probably, if you're on eCourseWare, then I'll upload a couple of design guides for you to have access to on the course website. But you just Google, you know, say ABS design guide. You'll probably find some supplier of ABS that has a nice design guide. Those should not be overlooked, the design guides. All right, then there are weld lines that can occur. This is more problematic in some products than in others. You can see a weld line here that's formed, and another, I believe that's another one right there. This mold is filled from this gate over here, and that means that the plastic has to go in two different directions to go around here. And so that front of the plastic kind of wants to skin over, And by the time it meets the other, the corresponding front of plastic on the other side, they've kind of skinned over, and when they meet back together, they will weld together, but not with the same strength that that the sort of the monolithic isotropic sort of plastic that has not been knit or welded back together will have. Also, the finished part appearance in some industries, like cosmetics and things like that, the whole product is about how it looks. Okay, so if you were gonna, go out and buy some kind of an anniversary present for your wife, and you're in the cosmetics, and it looks like just a trashy looking product. It's about how it looks. It's not so much about the product itself. In a lot of industries, it's about the presentation. And so, if a part just doesn't look right, then they don't sell. Okay, so. If you have, if you can look at the part and see that it's a lousy molding, then, in some industries that matters an awful lot. And of course, quality control issues, and cost issues. Cost is always, that's always going to be there. All right. So some of the features, you want to have, nice rounded corners. Injection molds prefer to be sort of nice rounded shapes. Let me just say that it's a really good idea to make it a habit of looking carefully at injection molded products. You might seem a little weird doing that. Don't do it in public. But if you see an injection molded spoon or a fork or some kind of these throwaway products, a lot of times they're made in pretty sophisticated molds, and it's good to see sort of what typical features look like on an injection mold. Pay attention to that. Look at the parts, how they're molded. Figure out how the mold accounted for undercuts and things like that. You can see places where slides happen, and we'll get to that later on. All right, so nice large radii. Ribs are a way to increase strength without increasing weight. A lot of times you can add a little bit of moment of inertia to a product and give it some stiffness just by adding some ribs. In fact, most of the time you'll see with injection molded parts, there are no thick cross sections in them. Okay, you might see thick cross sections in compression molded parts like circuit breakers and things like that, but in injection molded parts, the key is to keep everything a nice, even, consistent wall thickness, and not to have big thick sections. And so you may see some injection molded parts that give the impression that they are thick, like I've got a handle on a pump sprayer at home that kind of does this. You grab onto it and it seems like a nice thick robust part, but then you look at it carefully and you see that it's all done with ribs on the back side, that the molding is not solid throughout. It's been stiffened with ribs on the inside. And we already talked about draft, so I'm not going to get into that again. There's some numbers. 1.5 to 3 degrees per side is kind of typical. If you have a very, very slick surface, like a mirror finish on there, then you can get away with less a draft angle. If you start to have texture on the surface, then you really start to have more and more of a draft angle. And the more texture that you have, the more draft that you need. All right, now holes. So remember that holes in an injection molding are made with, there's a solid part there that the material has to flow around. So here's an example of a hole being molded. So this is the sort of the mandrel, the interior of the hole that's forming the hole itself. This is the plastic going around the hole. Notice that this is you're going to have weld lines and knit lines where this plastic comes back and rejoins. I know I used to have a cap off of an aerosol spray can that had some metal you know, some metal powder in it to give it sort of this glimmer look, this sort of shimmering look on this, like a spray paint bottle. And when they put a little hole in that bottle to allow the cap to go on and off, really, you know, to allow the air to escape, and the plastic around that flows, you can see plainly on that bottle cap. I'll try to get some pictures of it. I think I kept it. It's in my plastic products collection. But you can see where the knit line goes and just goes all the way down the side of the cap because that lousy little hole. So these holes, they cause problems, and you have to deal with them, carefully. So when you're designing holes, make sure that the hole is no closer than 3 hole diameters from the edge. So you can see this would not, if this were the edge of the part, this would fail that test, and you might wind up with a short shot where the plastic did not fill this area completely, or a weak spot where you have this weld line where it almost just kind of joins back together, but you have a weld line there that's going to cause some weakness. Keep holes 5 diameters apart from each other. Also, you know, be sure and oversize the hole so that if you're going to put a shaft in that hole, that you don't have something like a press fit arising. You want to make sure that you have clearance around it. Threads, you don't want to try to make super tight fitting threads. So you want to have class 1 or class 2 fits that have some healthy allowance in between the mating threads. All right, I think I already talked about the draft. You should know that plastic parts have some undesirable properties, like a large coefficient of thermal expansion. We talked about the shrinkage that occurs, but you know, also just when they get hot, they'll expand a lot. Creep is that elongation under load that happens over a long period of time, generally at elevated pressure. This is kind of what kept plastic parts out of your automotive engine housing for many, many years, until they started to use glass-filled ABS a lot. So you look under the hood of the car at some of the parts inside your car, you'll see it has a GF on the printed somewhere into the plastic part, or molded into the plastic part. A lot of times you'll see that. I know that my all my still lawn equipment all has PA6 GF, so it's all glass. I think it's PA. I'm not sure it's PA6, but it's polyamide nylon glass filled. So that glass filling will help mitigate against creep. So that's that elongation, that slow elongation over time, generally at an elevated temperature. Shrinkage and warpage can happen as soon as a part's molded. In fact, this is a big problem if you don't have proper cooling in your injection mold. The part comes out of the mold and it cools unevenly, and that's just warpage in an injection molded part is the easiest thing to get if the coolant is not, the cooling process is not well controlled. And then fatigue, that is the resistance to repeated loading and unloading. Kind of lousy among plastics. Some plastics do this better than others, like polypropylene, used a lot of times in products with what's called a living hinge. So that's where the hinge itself is molded in. Think like a cheap lunchbox or a real cheap toolbox that's molded all in one piece. That is, you know, the lid and the box itself are molded in one piece. That's called a living hinge. Let's see here. Injection mold design considerations. More of them. So you've got to think about the molding machine, the construction of the mold. We'll talk about multi-cavity molds. We'll talk about cold runner systems versus hot runner systems. We'll talk about gate design. We'll talk about cooling, ejection systems. Maybe talk a little bit. I think I got one slide on the on the surface finish, tooling material, you can mold in aluminum molds. Those are not considered, you know, for very high production runs. You may have some prototyping done in aluminum molds, or some real short run stuff can be made in aluminum molds, but there's a whole family of mold steels that are used for high production injection molding. And then finally, I think we got a slide in there about venting. All right, so we'll go through and look at some of the mold nomenclature. In a few slides here, I'll start to break apart a mold that looks kind of like this. I've realized over the years that when a student sees this, it's a little unfamiliar to them, and so I want to break that down a little bit. All right, so first of all, there are two sides to a mold. The two separate platens that open up, one of them remains stationary. That is, the A side remains stationary, and it has what's called the sprue bushing in it. So this sprue bushing is where the plastic enters into the mold from the injector screw. So you've got the screw plasticator on this side that's melting the plastic resin and mixing it together and pushing the air out and filling the cavity. It all goes into the cavity from the sprue bushing into what's called the A side, or the cavity side of the mold. The B side is the core side. Let's see. I got a slide of that. Yeah, okay. So this is this is the cavity side of the mold, and this is the core side. So keep in mind that, and this is a terrible illustration of this, because you know, it's this mold's not, you don't even see gates or runners or anything on here. But what's important is that this is the hollow part, the hollow bit here, and this is the solid bit on the inside. So remember that the plastics, as they cool, they shrink. Okay, so as they shrink, that means they're going to move away from the walls of the cavity, and they're going to tighten down and grab on to the walls of the core. So it's the core side that has the ejector pins on it, because it's the core that the product is going to stick to and has to be shed off of. All right. This little video, this is just an excerpt of somebody's training video. Really a good video to kind of start to get your bearings. Okay, so I would recommend that you watch that. It's in the lecture slides, obviously. All right, so we've seen that the material goes into the mold from the sprue. I probably should have put runners next. Okay, so why don't we just, okay. Well, anyway, at the other end where the material enters the mold, so it goes from the sprue to the runners, and the runners go through what's called a gate. So the gate is, it's like the gateway into the mold itself. So this is, you've seen where gates have been trimmed off. Anytime you look at a plastic product, you'll be able to find some little nip on it somewhere where you can tell that that's where the plastic went into the mold. You can almost always see that, okay? And so there are different types of gates, and different things will affect which type of gate, what gate design you choose. All right, so, and where you place that gate can be important, okay? Let's see here, so, Phil, we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about, we've already kind of talked about weld or knit lines and where that happens. We'll look at an example here in a second of how to eliminate that in certain circumstances. Let's see, orientation is important in some plastics. That is, how it flows into the mold affects the strength. It's like plastic has a grain to it, depending on, you know, some plastics are worse about this than others. But they get oriented as they fill into the mold, and sometimes that strength goes with the orientation of those plastics. Tolerances, sink marks. The easiest way to get sink marks in a plastic product is to have a change in wall thickness. So you've if you take a look at really any plastic part, look at if it has like a rib or something on the back side, then look at the front side, the opposite side of that rib, and almost invariably you'll be able to see a little shrinkage that happens, a little sink that happens where that wall thickness changes. So one way to control sink marks is by avoiding changes in wall thickness. Sometimes you can avoid this by the filling pattern of the mold, so by placing the gate really close to where the shrinkage would occur. Works kind of similar to like a riser in a casting. Well, let's see, pressure distribution, gas traps, and cold and short shots. We'll talk about that when we talk about venting. Degating, your design of your gate has everything to do with how well it can be degated. So sometimes degating, and the degating is separating the molded plastic product from the sprue and runner system that was used to create it. Let's see. All right, so one method is to gate from the side. So what you're seeing here is this little piece over here. This is the molded product, all right? And this is the sprue. So the sprue, this is being, hot plastic is being fed directly in this direction from the molding machine. Then it goes through a series of runners. That would be this section here, and then through the gate. So this gate is a side gate. A pretty common low-cost way to gate, and then this is going to be manually trimmed off, or you can have a trimming die that comes down and degates this part. But it has to be a separate sequence. All of this comes out together. Jumping straight ahead to some more complex gates is a submarine gate or a tunnel gate, where the gate actually goes down underneath the B side of the mold. So this is the core side. You can see here, this is the cavity side. It's attached to the sprue. This is the part that remains stationary. So the product, so when this thing opens up, the product's going to be shed off of this core, and this will be shed off separately. So I think I've got a little video clip of, yeah, there we go. All right, so this is a really nice little video clip of how a little submarine gate or tunnel gate works. Opens up, and you see now they are automatically degated. So this gets pulled off of the little gate down underneath here. And then this is called the sprue puller that's done its job of pulling this sprue out of the sprue bushing, and then it will be ejected off of there. Let's see, so we'll just watch that. Thanks to these folks. Who is this? Zilling Enterprise. Very, very handsome video there. All right, so a fan gate is kind of, this in this view here looks just like a side gate, but this is much thinner, so it thins out and allows you to distribute the plastic across a wider area there. Film gates, same idea, only thinner. This is, this maybe should have been the first slide of gating. This is a direct gate, and it is the most common, the cheapest, it's the cheapest, easiest, simplest way to gate. You may see this in like really cheap plastic buckets. You turn the bucket over, and you can see there's a gate right in the middle. That's pretty significant, that has to be trimmed off again in a secondary step. All right, so where you gate can make a difference in how the material fills the mold, and this is a really good example of that. Okay, so let's say that we have this plastic part. Say this is a some kind of a cap or a bucket or something like that, and let's say we take the conventional route and we fill right here from the outside in the middle. You can see that as the plastic flows, it's going to flow out in all directions equally, all right, with no weld lines or knit lines or anything. However, if we gate over here from the side, maybe say down here at this location, then the plastic is going to have to go all the way around back and forth, and you'll probably wind up with a seam with a knit line that goes down the opposite side here. Okay, so where your gate can have some influence on the cosmetic appearance, the aesthetics of the molded part, as well as the strength. All right, so sprues. This is a sprue bushing that I was talking about. This aligns with the nozzle on the screw plasticator on the screw side of the injection molding machine. The plastic will be forced in here. Notice that it tapers away from where the plastic comes in. This is going to get pulled out of here by a thing called a sprue puller, which is a molded in feature. The injector nozzle is located with this locating ring. Yeah, there's the sprue puller. So here we have the sprue. This is happening inside that sprue bushing. There is generally on the back side of where the sprue goes in, you'll see this little tapered cone shape on the back side. And that goes against the draw direction of the opening. So this is a reverse taper, a reverse draft. It's designed to stick. It's designed to grab on. And what happens when the mold opens up, you know, the plastic is going to shrink down onto the core side, and the sprue puller is going to, you know, this bit here is going to solidify, and that's going to allow this to yank the sprue out of that sprue bushing. And then there's an ejection pin right on the back side of this that sheds this back out of that hole. I'll try to get some pictures. I've got some samples of some mold samples downstairs. I'll try to get some pictures in. All right, then there are the runners. Let's see, have I got a good picture of some runners? All right, so the runners carry the plastic from the sprue through to the gates of each cavity in the mold. So if you have multiple cavities in the mold, each of those cavities is going to be fed by at least one runner. So these are done in different profiles. A rounded cross section is a good idea. It's probably the best. But it requires you to machine both sides of the mold and then they have to come back together. You'll see sometimes that only one half of the mold is machined, so the runner is only in one half, and a lot of times you'll see maybe a trapezoid shape of the cross section of a runner. One thing that's done is to have hot runner molds. That is, and I'll talk a little bit more about this, but these are designed to keep the mold molten, or keep the plastic melted as it even after it's entered into the cavity. Okay, so this is an example. Here we go. This is an example of a hot runner mold. Okay, so this is a Lego product, and this plastic has been injected in here from the same method as any other plastic, but this stays in here, and there's a heater that's keeping this part molten. This bit cools down completely, and when this opens up, there's a little poppet valve that closes off, seals the gate, and when this mold opens up, this part is ready to go on the store shelf. It doesn't require any kind of further processing at all. So that's a hot runner mold. And I think I've got some more on that here in a little bit. Another sort of a poor man's hot runner mold is the insulated runner mold, where, let me just put this back here for a second. In an insulated runner mold, which this is not, you just have a really thick runner system, a really wide runner system, and the plastic itself will kind of solidify on the outside, but you have so much of it that it never solidifies all the way. So you keep production going, you keep pushing molten plastic through, and the the plastic is a really good insulator. It insulates itself and keeps the interior molten so that you can keep molding. So that would be an insulated runner mold. That's my poor man's diagram of an insulated runner mold. All right, so a hot runner mold is one method of automatic degating. This little video, I think, shows you that. Again, this is another pretty good one. Who is this? All right, CAD and Mechanism on YouTube. It's got a pretty good little collection there. But this is the one. Oh, that's not what I wanted to see. Hang on. All right, we're back from the commercial. This is a three-plate mold. Okay, so you see, let me just pause that there for a second. You can see the sprue here. Here's the runner. And here we have the going into the gates into the mold cavity. So this is like a cup-shaped mold. Again, direct gating in the top here. One of the what's happened here is that you have a three-plate mold. So it has this additional plate where you're actually molding the runner system, the sprue and runner system, as its own component, as its own part. And then you have the part itself here. So this opens up, first of all, and does the automatic degating. It rips the gate out of the end of the molded part, and then the part gets ejected separately. So this opens up, and then you eject out the part separately. So very nice animation there. Like and subscribe to that guy. All right, so that's a cold runner three-plate mold. You can also do this with tunnel gates like we've already seen. So these are ways of automatically degating the part, that is, separating the part from the molded sprue and runner system. So using hot runner will increase production, reduces the cycle time. You have material savings-ish because you don't have to worry about the waste stream being recycled back in. So in most of these, let me just pop back to this. When you mold this sprue system in any of these other techniques that we've talked about, these other processes, you can, these are thermoplastics, you can chop this up and re-enter that in, you know, at least in some amount into the regrind and just keep using that. And of course, then you can claim that you're using recycled material in your product. But you don't have to worry about that at all with hot runner molds. You just eliminate that entire stream of material flow. Good quality improvement. You're not wasting anything. The automating, the degating is automatic. Energy savings. Flexible choice of gate location. Some of the disadvantages, really, they are high cost. They are more expensive. You're going to do these when you've got really high production runs. When you're going to be able to set up a mold and just run and run and run and run, then they become a good idea. But this little video, if it's the one I'm thinking of, it's pretty good. He goes through and shows a typical rebuild of a hot runner mold. So that's awfully interesting. Tooling docs on that one. Here's a little animation of a hot runner mold. This is from Alan Froelich. So this animation is pretty good. If I lose my train of thought, it's because I accidentally having to come back and re-record some of this because I forgot to hit pause a second time. But anyway, let me come back, watch this. All right, so there's the mold opening up. He's going to do a section view here. All right, inside here you can see the hot runners. So this is all heated inside of here, so all of this plastic stays molten. There's a little poppet valve inside there that's going to close off the gate, and when it opens up, it will automatically be degated. So a real nice high production way of making parts there. All right, that's where I messed up last time. So re-recording this little bit, hopefully I'll have some continuity there. All right, so One thing to keep in mind, this is not a hard and fast rule, but it's one of those best case scenarios. You know, you're going to dump a lot of money into an injection mold. You want to try to eliminate as many potential problems as you can. So the best case, the best practice is to make each cavity in the mold an equal distance away from the sprue. So that means that the plastic will travel the same distance to fill every single mold or every single cavity in the mold. On this side, that's not the case. So it travels less distance to get to this cavity than it would to get to these side cavities. So you may wind up with some inconsistencies in the material properties of the in the molding quality of the parts coming out of this cavity as you might get coming out of one of these side cavities. So I've seen lots and lots of injection molds that don't adhere to this, but it is the best practice. All right, one thing that that is really common that you'll see everywhere is this little cold slug weld. So let me fix this. Okay, that's better. So what this does is when the plastic is flowing in this direction, so let me grab this pointer here, plastic is flowing in this direction, and as it flows, the plastic kind of cools and skins over on the front surface as it moves through. So what these do is when it reaches a cold slug well, that sort of semi-solidified front of material that's kind of skinned over, instead of going into the cavity, that was another scam. Okay, so anyway, as the material flows in here, that little skin winds up going into this cold slug well, and then new fresh plastic branches off. So at these branches, you have an opportunity to sort of get rid of that old front of plastic and refresh it with a nice new front as it moves through the runners. All right. This next few slides, the series of slides, are use a model that was uploaded to GrabCAD by Hariharan Kashirajan, I believe that's something like you might pronounce it. My apologies if that's not right. But what you can do is go on to GrabCAD, and if you don't already have an account, make an account. I think you have to have an account. But you can download this entire injection mold. And take it apart. It's one assembly in NX. You can take it apart and maybe get a better understanding than just looking at slides of it will give you. But I've tried to take this apart and kind of render it in pieces that you can see what's kind of going on. So we will we'll look through this. First of all, this is the product. I have no idea what it actually is, but if you look at it, you can see immediately that it violates some of the rules that we've talked about. You know, it's got undercuts here. It's got undercuts inside here. How do you mold something like this? How do you get this to actually open up? And that's what we're going to take a look at. So first of all, the part of the cavity side of this mold is a slide. So this is one half of this part. So back here on the back side, you can see that it's tapered. So what that does, when the mold comes together, there's a cam action that pushes the two halves of these slides together. And then this is coming up from the sprue. The sprue will fill through the runner system each of these cavities. You can also see that little cold slug well on there. All right, so this opens up in two directions, and in that direction, there is no undercut. So as this thing opens up, perpendicular to this, it slides away, and this is made in such a way that there's no undercut at all if you open in that direction. Then inside here, the core, this little core insert forms the interior of the component. And you can see that it's got some accommodations in here for ejection pins. And also, we'll look at some core slides that go down in there. Here are those core slides. The way that these work, you can see here that they are forming the negative space inside of this undercut. And the way that this works, it may be a little bit confusing, but as this mold opens up, as the ejection pins push this plastic product off of the core slides move with the ejection pins. So what that means is that this surface on the little core slide remains flush with the surface of the molded part. It just moves out from the cavity here, from this little hole here, it moves out in that direction. And of course, the top part of this is filled in with detail from the core that's been sectioned away that you don't see there. Oh, and I will mention, take a look on injection molded parts. Look at them, and you'll a part that has some kind of an undercut, and see if you can identify how they dealt with that undercut. A lot of times you'll be able to see, you might get some insight. You might see, well, there's actually not an undercut. It only looks like there's an undercut. Sometimes there is an undercut like this, and you'll be able to see where the core slide actually moved in and out. You'll see that witness mark of that on the molded part. So these are the ejection pins, like we talked about. As the plastic solidifies and cools, it closes and shrinks down around the core. And what these ejection pins do is shed that plastic part off of the core. You see they're mounted separately from the core. They can move independent of it. This is the ejector pin retainer plate. And the core slide pullers, don't be confused by the name, because first of all, they're going to push those cores, the core slides, in. And they move, like I said, at the same rate as the ejection pins. You see, this is all mounted together on the same plate, and that all moves together. And that means that the motion of the core slide relative to the part is the same. It only slides out slides out of the undercut. There's the ejector plate. And all of this is where the motion of the ejector pins comes from. It's from pushing this pin in, and this all slides together. So here you see the assembly. This is pretty much the B side of the mold here. Okay, so this is going to be the side that moves independent. It's a little bit funny because it is forming sort of the cavity here in the B side. Which it gets moved in with the with that cam action. So if you do download this model and go through it, you'll be able to pick it apart and see those kinds of things. Springs here to reverse the ejector plate back into position. This return pin that's going to hold the ejector plate back in the open position. When it opens up, it's going to stop it. It works against the springs there. And then there is the interlock that aligns the two halves of the mold. All right, and so there I think that brings me up to speed for the part that I forgot, that I didn't record properly. And then here's the little interlock that aligns the two halves of the mold. So we've seen about half of it so far. Now working on the cavity side, you can see this is an insert that's been machined to form the cavity side, and most of the cavity side here is formed with slides. The rest is formed with these inserts. Now this is the all of this being the A side. This is what connects to the machine. This part doesn't move. Okay, so this is fixed in the machine. This is going to be the entry point. This is generally shown, I don't know, you see it more often on the right-hand side for some reason of illustrations, but I'll try to get you situated. But this is what attaches to the nozzle. So this is the business end. There's our sprue bushing. And I don't see a sprue puller on this one, but you almost always do see it. I guess this little T here acts a lot like a sprue bushing, because this is going to pull out before it gets ejected off. And let's see, so we got the insert in there, sprue bushing, this is the interlock, and this is where it connects to the actual molding machine. So there's the assembly overall. Again, down here, everything below this parting line is the A side, and everything above it up here would be the B side. This is the part that moves in and out. All right, so tipping the whole thing up into a typical view that you would see of an injection molding machine. Here is the sprue, sprue bushing going in. There's your cavity. It closes down on the core. So like I said, it's maybe a little bit more complicated than you think until you start kind of getting into it. This is from a design guide, this DSM design guide. I will try to make sure that's available on the eCourseWare site, because this looks like a real good test question just waiting to happen right there. Okay, so hopefully going through and seeing some of that, how this actually looks in real life, hopefully that'll help you kind of get your bearings on this a little bit better. Students I've noticed in the past kind of struggled with this, and so that's why I went through and put those mold models together. We've talked about coring. We saw that in the mold. If you're on campus, you can see in the display case outside of ET112, there is this. This is actually a wax injection mold for an investment casting process, but you can see it has a little core on there. It's cam-operated. Cam actuated. Here's another. This little video is about coring and actuating cores. So there, we saw in the mold that we looked at, all of those cores are cam actuated. It's all done with inclined planes. But you can power cores. You can have cores that are powered. There's a cam action. You can have them powered by hydraulic and electric. And pneumatic actuators, like you see in that little video. Pretty. This guy has a real nice series of videos, on injection molding. Whole really nice channel. Who is this? All right, Train Interactive. Whoops. So go check those out. We already talked about hot runners. I need to probably pull that slide out of there. All right, so vents. As you fill this mold up, you have to displace the air that was inside the mold. Okay, so what you do is you cut in little passageways to allow the air to escape. So if you don't have enough venting, what you can wind up with, number one, is some short shots. That is, the mold doesn't fill completely. And so then you decide, well, I'll just increase my molding pressure and try to get that thing to fill out. And what you may wind up with are little burned marks on the plastic and streaks, because what happens when you pressurize a mold really, really quickly is you get this adiabatic heating, which is that's the process that makes a diesel engine work. So when you take and compress that air-fuel mixture, you get combustion because you compress it. It will increase the temperature, and it'll increase it so much that fuels will burn, and plastics being hydrocarbons, they will burn. So you can wind up with burn marks and streaks if you don't have proper vent design. Do design these vents on what's called the steel safe or the metal safe side. That is, these will generally get kind of worked in as you're proving out a mold. So don't go in and design a real great big vent, because they have to be big enough to let the air get out, but they have to be small enough that they stop the plastic from flowing. So so you want to be in that nice balance zone there. I think we've talked about ejector pins. Cooling channels we didn't talk about. Super, super important. The cooling... If a mold doesn't cool properly, I think I've already said this, you will get warpage. It's just a fact of life. So so if you open up a mold and the part hasn't cooled properly, and it's not going to cool evenly when it comes out of the mold, and you're going to get warpage. So that means you've got to wait until the part has cooled enough. Well, if you wait very long, you're not going to make any money. So what you do is you allow coolant to flow through the mold. Let me just drop over here. I still have this this illustration up, this photo of the Lego hot runner mold. These are the cooling channels. They've illustrated them there in blue. So you see that they're flowing around. That's to suck the heat out of the mold. And you want to do that quickly because you're trying to make as many parts in a shift as you can. But if you don't get the heat out, you get the warpage. So there's those two go hand in hand. Let's see. So one of the, let's see here. Well, let me move on. One of the neat things that's being done here recently is to use 3D printing to work in the mold manufacturing stage. So the metal 3D printing is not going to produce the kind of finish that you would need with an injection mold. You're still going to have to come back and, you know, like they're doing there, and do a machining operation to get the mold finished. But what it allows you to do by 3D printing is you can print these interior passageways. You can print these conformal cooling passages, as they're called, and you can allow them to surround the mold all around. Okay, so compared to the conventional kind, these are the 3D printed kind. This is a real advantage. Okay, so and this is done. This is not sort of pie in the sky kind of stuff. This is actually done. All right, so in general, there's some guidelines, and like I said, I will post a design guide online. If I don't, I'll try to get that done as soon as I'm done getting this up there. But really good to go through those design guides and see what's recommended. And that goes, you know, for any kind of process that you're new to, always be in touch with whoever is going to be doing the manufacturing end of it. Be in touch with them, understand their specific capabilities before, you know, early in the design process. All right. Let's see here. I think we talked about that. You should, you know, be thinking about the parting line as you're designing. Kind of keep that in the back of your mind. How's the mold going to open up? How am I going to make this part easy on my molder? How did my mold designer? All right, we talked in processes too about surface finish, and there are, you know, there's standard ways of referring to surface finish. The mold industry has sort of their own mold surface finish designations, and you can see those here. I think there's a pretty good link there out to the SPI. It is now plasticindustry.org, so that link, I'll have to patch that up. But anyway, different mold surface finishes specific to the injection molding industry. Some other things to think about: getting the flash, or, well, in this case, this is a vacuum thermoforming, so very commonly you'll have to trim off the excess material around a vacuum thermoforming. This is not an injection molded part, but you can have the same kind of, you can have degating dyes. It works in kind of a similar way. This is a really good, this is a How It's Made video. I guess he ripped that off of How It's Made. Hopefully that's still available. Okay, so I would really recommend that you go through, I mean, I'm not going to recommend that you watch that. I'm going to put that on the test. So make sure that you watch that video, that How It's Made video. Then a little side note, there are ways of making sort of prototype injection mold tooling. So there's an awful lot of money that can get tied up in molds really quickly, and if there's a problem with a part, it's easy, you know, it's best to head that off early. One thing you can do, and these videos kind of go into that, is to use certain rapid prototyping parts have the ability to kind of serve as injection molds. You have to use lower clamping pressures and lower molding pressures, lower molding temperatures and things like that, so you're not going to get an exact duplicate of the injection molding, but it can answer a lot of questions. So a really low risk, low cost way of proving out a part. So kind of interesting stuff there. And this is from SME, another pretty interesting video there. All right, so those are thoughts on injection mold design, and we'll see you later.